Hello friends, welcome to anujindal.in. So in this video, I am going to discuss the syllabus for economics in detail for the upcoming SEBI grade A examination. So guys, the objective of this video is to make you aware with the syllabus of economics in depth, so that if you want to prepare for the examination on your own, you can do so. And also, this video will be very beneficial for the enrolled students, because they will get an insight into what all is covered in our course. So without wasting any time, let's begin. So this is the syllabus which was given in the last year notification of SEBI grade A examination. So demand and supply, market structure, national income, classical versus Keynesian economics, okay? Consumption function, investment function, multiplier, demand and supply for money, ISLM curve, inflation, Phillips curve, business cycle, BOP, foreign exchange markets, monetary and fiscal policy, and non-banking financial institutions. So these are the broad areas which you need to study. But I will tell you that in each area or in each topic, what are the subtopics which you have to cover, okay? So let us take them one by one. So first of all, demand. So what all do you need to study in demand? So first of all, what is the meaning of demand? How it is different from desire or need or want, okay? Then what is the demand function, okay? Then demand curve. So demand curve is a downward sloping curve, okay? Then what is the law of demand? This is very, very important. Then after that, derivation of demand curve, okay? So how demand curve is being derived. Then two very important part of demand are income and substitution effect. So you should know the difference between the two and how these two result into the law of demand. Okay. Then relationship between the demand and the income. So there is a relation between price and demand, and there is also relation between income and demand. Okay. So basically there are two classifications, normal goods and inferior goods. Then exceptions to the law of demand. So there are certain exceptions like Giffen goods, Veblen goods, okay? Then what are substitutes and what are complements? This is also very, very important, and MCQ can be asked from this topic also. Then what is the difference between shift in demand curve versus movement along the demand curve? So one thing is the shift, rightward or leftward shift, okay? And one thing is the movement along the demand curve. So maybe upward movement or downward movement, okay? Then what is market demand? So basically market demand is a summation of individual demand curves. Then next topic is elasticity of demand. Very, very important again. Numerical question can also be asked from elasticity topic, okay? So what is the meaning of elasticity? What are the different types of elasticity? So basically there are three types: price elasticity, income elasticity, and cross elasticity, okay? So in price elasticity, what you have to study, first of all, the meaning, then what are the methods. So there are various methods like total expenditure method, percentage method, okay? Then there is point elasticity, arc elasticity, okay? Then relationship between marginal revenue and elasticity. So there is an equation which gives the relation between MR and elasticity, okay? Then degrees of elasticity. So the demand curve can be perfectly elastic or perfectly inelastic. It can be unitary elastic, okay? Then factors affecting elasticity, again very, very important. Then what is income elasticity, okay? So the meaning of income elasticity, what are normal goods, what are inferior goods, and what is the elasticity of normal goods and inferior goods, okay? Then cross elasticity, so again the meaning and the types of cross elasticity. Now moving on, next topic is supply, okay? So supply, first of all, the meaning of supply, then what are the factors which affect the supply? There are different types of factors like the prices of inputs or the technology, okay? Then what is the difference between stock and supply? These two are important terms. There is a basic difference between stock and supply. Then what is the supply curve? What is the shape of supply curve? It is upward sloping, okay? From left to right. Then market supply curve is basically the summation of individual supply curves. Then what is the law of supply? So as you have a law of demand, similarly you have a law of supply. Then reasons for the law of supply, very, very important again. Then exceptions to the law of supply. So just you have like exceptions to law of demand, You have also exceptions to law of supply, and one of them is perishable goods. So perishable goods do not follow the law of supply. Okay. Then movement along the supply curve and shift in supply curve. Then market equilibrium. So basically the intersection of demand curve and the supply curve is the equilibrium point. Then price elasticity of supply. Okay. The methods, so again there are different methods to of calculating elasticity of supply, and kinds of elasticity. So again, it can be zero, it can be infinity, it can be one, it can be more than one, or it can be less than one. Okay. Now moving on. Next is utility analysis. So this is basically from the consumer point of view. Okay. So first of all, what is the meaning of utility? So utility is the want satisfying capacity of a product. Then there are two approaches, cardinal and ordinal utility. Okay. So in cardinal utility analysis, first of all, you should know the meaning of cardinal utility. Then what are the assumptions of this approach? Then measures like total utility, marginal utility. Okay. Then law of diminishing marginal utility. This law is very, very important. You should be aware of this concept thoroughly. Okay. Then relationship between total utility and marginal utility, you should know the relationship and how their how their curves are being drawn. Okay. Then equilibrium as per this approach. So how do we arrive at the equilibrium as per the cardinal utility approach? Okay. And then the weakness of cardinal utility approach, again the limitations, very, very important. Okay. Then next is ordinal utility analysis. Okay. So what are the assumptions of ordinal utility analysis? This you need to study. What is the meaning of ordinal utility? What is indifference curve? Very, very important. Indifference curve is central to this analysis, central part to this analysis. Okay. Then law of diminishing marginal rate of substitution. So marginal rate of substitution, MRS, it is the slope of indifference curve. And there is a law of diminishing MRS. Okay. Then features of indifference curve. There are different features of indifference curve. Then what is consumer budget? What is budget line? What is budget set? And what are budget constraints? Again, very, very important. And finally, the consumer's equilibrium as per the ordinal utility analysis. So basically, how do we arrive at the equilibrium as per ordinal utility analysis? Okay, so this all you need to cover under utility. Then after consumer comes the producer. Okay. So in producer, you need to study, first of all, the production function. Then what is the difference between short run and long run? Okay. Then concept of product. So there is total product, there is average product, and there is marginal product. So you need to know the difference between the three. Then what is the meaning of returns to a factor? Okay. Then what is law of variable proportions? So there are three stages in this law. So you need to know all the three stages. Okay. Then there is law of diminishing returns. Then after that, relationship between average product and marginal product. So how the graphs of these two are being drawn and how they are related to each other. Okay. Then returns to scale. Okay. Then what is isoquant? So you have indifference curve. Similarly, you have isoquant in case of producer. Okay. So what is the slope of isoquant and what are the characteristics of isoquant? Then there is iso cost line. So you just like in consumer equilibrium, you have budget line. In producer equilibrium, you have iso cost line. Okay. And what is the slope of iso cost line? Then producer equilibrium, there are two cases. So both the cases you need to study. And finally, optimal expansion path in the long run and in the short run. So these are the various topics under producer equilibrium. Next comes the cost part, theory of cost. So first of all, how do we define the cost function? So in cost function, there are two variables, cost and the output. Okay. Then short run cost. What is the meaning of short run cost? So you have TFC, total fixed cost. You have TVC, total variable cost. And you have TC, total cost. So total cost basically is the sum of TFC and TVC. Okay. So you need to know the relationship between these three. Okay. How do we draw the curve of these three? Then you have average fixed cost, average variable cost, and average cost. Again, the relationship between these three. Then after that comes the marginal cost. Okay. How do we draw the graph of marginal cost? Then relationship between average cost and marginal cost, and relationship between total cost and marginal cost. Again, very, very important. Then after short run cost, we have long run cost. In long run cost, we have LAC, long run average cost. And this long run average cost, it is derived from short run average cost curves. Okay. So all the short run average cost curves, when basically they are joined or their point is joined, so LAC is being derived. Okay. Then after that comes the market structure. Okay. So there are different types of market structure like perfect competition, monopoly, monopolistic competition, oligopoly, and duopoly. So what you need to study in perfect competition, you need to study first of all the meaning, then what are the assumptions of perfect competition, then the demand curve. How does the demand curve of a perfect competition look like? Then MR and AR, marginal revenue and average revenue, and the relationship between these two. Then what is the short run equilibrium and what is the long run equilibrium? Okay, the conditions of the equilibrium. Then monopoly. So what are the features of monopoly? The demand curve, MR, AR, their relationship. Okay, and then short run equilibrium, long run equilibrium, and finally an important feature, a distinctive feature of monopoly is price discrimination. And there are different degrees of price discrimination, like first degree, second degree, third degree. Okay. Then after that comes the monopolistic competition. So what are the features of monopolistic competition? How the demand curve is drawn, then MR, AR, short run equilibrium and long run equilibrium. And there are different models for long run equilibrium. Okay. Then oligopoly. So what are the features of oligopoly market structure? And a very important model of oligopoly is kinked demand curve model. This you have to do very, very thoroughly. Then finally is duopoly. So duopoly is a special case of oligopoly in which there are only two firms. Okay. And there are different models of duopoly like Cournot's model, Edgeworth, and Chamberlain. So these three are important particularly. Okay. Now moving on. Next is national income, Keynesian approach, and classical approach. Okay. So we have come to the macroeconomics now. Okay. So what you all need to study in this, first of all, the basic terminologies like what are final goods, what are intermediate goods. Okay. Then circular flow of income. What is the meaning of circular flow of income? So there are different factors of production like land, labor, capital, and entrepreneurship. Okay. So these factors of production, they make certain contribution, and against this contribution, they get remuneration. So there is a circular flow of income. Okay. Then there are different methods to calculate national income. Basically, value-added method, expenditure method, and income method. And recently, a new method has also been developed. And as per this new method, the base year has been changed. Okay. And there has been some change in the methodology also. Okay. Then what is the difference between microeconomics and macroeconomics? Very, very important. Then Great Depression. So this is a major world event, Great Depression. And basically after Great Depression, you can say that there was a change in the viewpoint of economists. Okay. So what is the difference between Keynesian and classical approach? Okay. This is very, very important. Again, how John Maynard Keynes changed the entire structure or entire face of macroeconomics, how he challenged the assumptions of macroeconomics. Okay. And then finally, certain macroeconomic identities like how to calculate GDP, how to calculate GNP. Okay. What is NNP? What is factor cost? What is market price? So all these identities you should study. Now moving on. Next is consumption function and investment function. Okay. So first of all, you should study what is the meaning of consumption function. Okay. What are the various inputs? What are the output? What is the meaning of autonomous consumption? Okay. So autonomous consumption is basically that consumption which is independent of the level of income, you can say, or the level of output. Then what is MPC? Marginal propensity to consume. Okay. This is very, very important. MPC. Then what is the savings function? MPS, marginal propensity to save. Okay. Then what are the determinants of consumption and saving? Okay. So what are the factors which influence consumption and saving? Then investment function. Okay. Very important. Determinants of investment. So one of the determinants is rate of interest. and one is marginal efficiency. Okay, then aggregate demand and aggregate supply. So what is aggregate demand? What is the meaning of aggregate demand? What is the meaning of aggregate supply? And how do these two curves intersect each other? Okay. Then equilibrium in two sector and four sector model. Okay. This is also very, very important from your examination point of view. Now next is multiplier and accelerator. Okay. So what is the meaning of multiplier in economics? Okay. What is the multiplier theory? What is the mechanism and what is the working of multiplier? Okay. Then for your example point of view, two types of multiplier are important: spending multiplier and tax multiplier. So you should know the formulas of these two, because small numerical questions can be asked. Okay. Then what is the paradox of thrift? Very, very important. So thrift means savings. So this paradox is important. Then what is the meaning of accelerator? Okay. Now next is demand and supply for money and ISLM curve. So ISLM model is a very important model. Okay. So IS stands for investment saving and LM stands for liquidity money. This ISLM model is also called Higgs-Hansen model. Okay. Higgs-Hansen model. This is another name. Okay. Then what is the meaning of demand for money? Okay, so there are three types of demands. Okay, then what is the meaning of supply of money? Okay, then putting ISLM together. Okay, so IS curve is downward sloping, LM curve is upward sloping. So this is the equilibrium. So basically IS is for goods market and LM is for money market. Okay, then shifts in ISLM curve. So when do IS and LM curve shift? So there can be different factors like fiscal policy, change in the fiscal policy or change in the monetary policy, which can lead to shifts in IS or LM curve. Okay. Now next is inflation. So inflation, this topic is also there. If you look at your syllabus, it is also there in the finance theory syllabus. Okay. So there is overlap. Okay. Now what you need to study in inflation? First of all, the difference between inflation, deflation and disinflation. Very, very important. Then what is the difference between headline inflation and core inflation? This you must have read or listened or heard in news channels. They talk about headline inflation, core inflation. Okay, so what is the fundamental difference between these two? Okay, then CPI stands for consumer price index. It is a measure of inflation. So what are the components of CPI? And there are different variants like CPI rural, CPI urban, CPI combined, CPI industrial workers, CPI agricultural laborers and CPI rural laborers. Okay, then WPI, it stands for wholesale price index. So what are the different components of WPI? So basically there are three components of WPI. And what is WPI food index? Then difference between CPI and WPI. So there are some differences between CPI and WPI that you should study. Then what is producer price index, PPI? Okay, this is also important. And finally, the measure of inflation which has been adopted by RBI. Okay, that you should know. Now next is Phillips curve. So basically Phillips curve shows the relationship between unemployment and inflation. So these two factors are taken, unemployment and inflation. Okay, unemployment and inflation. So the relationship between these two is depicted by Phillips curve. So you should study the meaning of Phillips curve. What is the meaning of Phillips curve? What is stagflation? Very, very important. Because stagflation has led to the failure of Phillips curve. So in the history, the Phillips curve has failed. Why? Because due to stagflation. Okay. Then what is short-run Phillips curve? How does short-run Phillips curve look like? And how does long-run Phillips curve look like? That you should know. Then what is natural rate of unemployment, NRU? Okay, this is also very, very important concept related to Phillips curve only. Okay, and then finally the relationship between aggregate demand, aggregate supply and Phillips curve. Okay, so how does a shift in aggregate demand or aggregate supply affects the Phillips curve? Now next is business cycle. Business cycle is also called as economic cycle. Okay, so what is the meaning of business cycle? What are the different stages of business cycle? So basically business cycle, you can show it like this: up, down, up, down. Okay, so this is basically the peak, the topmost point, and the lowermost point is called the trough. Okay, trough is called the trough. So economic boom. What is economic boom? When the economy is growing. So what are the characteristics of economic boom? Okay, then what is the meaning of economic slowdown? Then what is recession and what are the characteristics of economic recession? Then what is depression? So depression is a severe form of recession only. Okay, then what is the meaning of economic recovery? And then finally, what is the meaning of growth recession? So these all you need to study under business cycles. Then next is balance of payments, BOP, very important. So what is the meaning of BOP? What are the components? So the different components of BOP are current account, capital account and official reserve account. Okay, so what is current account? What are the components? So there are different components of current account like trade in goods, trade in services, factor income, unilateral transfers. Okay, then what is the J-curve effect? So J-curve effect is connected with your current account only. Okay, then what is capital account and the components? So the different components of capital account are FDI, FPI, purchase and sale of fixed assets. Okay, then what are errors and omissions? What is official reserve account? So there are different components of official reserve account of India like gold, okay, special drawing rights, forex, foreign exchange, okay, and reserve position in IMF. Then what is the difference between autonomous transactions and accommodating transactions? Very important. Then quality of deficit. So if there is a BOP deficit, so it is not compulsory that BOP deficit is harmful or it is bad. Sometimes it is an indicator of a bright future. Okay, so if the expenditure is spent, let's say if there is expenditure on building capital goods or building infrastructure, so then this BOP deficit is going to convert into BOP surplus in the future. Okay, so quality of deficit is very important. Then what is the importance of BOP? Like what is the importance of studying BOP? Okay, then causes of disequilibrium in BOP. So there are political factors, economic factors, social factors. Okay, then how can we correct disequilibrium? So disequilibrium can be corrected either automatically or through deliberate measures also. Okay, so deliberate measures are different types of measures like trade related measures or other miscellaneous measures. Okay, then next is foreign exchange market. So again, this is also given in your syllabus of finance. Okay, so what is forex market? So first of all, you should know what is the difference between nominal and real exchange rate. What is REER, real effective exchange rate, and what is NEER, nominal effective exchange rate. Okay, then if we will study the history, you have to study the history of forex market. So initially there used to be gold standard where currencies were freely convertible into gold. Then after gold standard failed after the First World War. So in 1944, after the Second World War, the Bretton Woods was established under which IMF and World Bank were formed. So in 1944, fixed exchange rate system was adopted in which US dollar became the reserve currency for the world. Okay, and then there is Triffin dilemma. Then what is flexible exchange rate system? So after the failure of fixed exchange rate system, flexible exchange rate system was adopted by the world. What are the merits and demerits of flexible exchange rate system? Okay, then what is managed floating exchange rate system? Okay, then what is the difference between bid rate and ask rate? Okay, there are two types of rate in forex market, bid rate and ask rate for every currency. Okay, then difference between direct quote and indirect quote. Okay, what is the purpose of forex market? So there are different purpose or uses of forex market like speculation, hedging, arbitrage, okay, currency conversion. Then what is the difference between spot rate, cross rate and forward rates? And what is the difference between swaps, options and futures? So these all you need to cover under forex market. Next is very important, monetary policy. So monetary policy is being formulated by the Reserve Bank of India. So what is the meaning of monetary policy? What are the objectives? Like one of the objectives is inflation targeting or keeping the inflation under control and the growth of the economy. Then what are the different types of monetary policy? Like basically two types, contractionary policy and expansionary policy. Okay, then monetary policy tools, there are different monetary policy tools like repo rate, reverse repo rate, bank rate, open market operations. Okay, CRR is cash reserve ratio, then statutory liquidity ratio. Okay, then operation twist, very very important. Then difference between expansionary and contractionary monetary policy. Okay, then what is LAF? Liquidity adjustment facility, market stabilization scheme, marginal standing facility. So all these abbreviations are very very important because these are important concepts and direct MCQ can be asked. Okay, then what is the meaning of monetary policy transmission? Okay, then different types of monetary policy instruments, they can be categorized under two headings: quantitative instruments and qualitative instruments. Okay, then monetary policy committee, MPC. So what are the functions of MPC and what is the constitution of MPC? Okay, then monetary policy stances of RBI. So there are different stances like accommodative stance, neutral stance, okay, hawkish stance. Then evolution of monetary policy framework in India. So basically the history of monetary policy framework in India. So these are some of the important topics. Then next is fiscal policy. So under fiscal policy, first of all, you have to study the functions of government. There are three major functions of government. Okay. Then overview of government budget. So basically revenue budget and capital budget. You have revenue receipts, capital receipts, and you have expenditure of the government. Okay. Then you under revenue receipt, you have tax and non-tax sources of revenue. Okay. Then you have types of deficits. So there can be different types of deficits like revenue deficit, fiscal deficit, primary deficit. So there is a formula to calculate these different types of deficits. So you should know the formula. Okay. Then how can the government finance the deficit? So there are different ways of financing government deficit like taxes. Okay. Or the government can go for WMS, ways and means advances. Okay. Then Laffer curve. This is also very important. Then ways and means advances. Then what is the impact of deficit on the economy? So there is adverse effect like crowding out of investment, private investment. This is an adverse effect of deficit of government. Or there can also be inflationary pressure on the economy. Okay. So these are some of the bad effects of government deficit. Then very, very important, FRBM Act of 2003. This act is very important. Okay. Fiscal Responsibility and Budget Act. Okay. So there are different documents which have to be laid before the parliament. So that you have to study this act. The next, the final topic is non-banking financial institutions. Okay. So you should know what is the meaning of non-banking financial institutions and how are they different from banks. Okay. So there are some features which make them different from banks, like non-banking institutions, they cannot accept demand deposits. They cannot, you know, give deposit guarantee. Okay. So this makes them different from banks. Okay. And then there are different categories of NBFIs, like All India Financial Institutions. All India Financial Institutions means like Exim Bank. Okay. NABARD, NHB, SIDBI. Okay. Then there are primary dealers who deal in the government securities. And then finally, the most important part is NBFCs, non-banking financial companies. Okay. So a lot of recent regulations have come up regarding NBFCs. So there are different types of NBFCs. So NBFCs can be categorized based on liability, based on size, and based on their activity. Okay. So then next you need to study about the regulation of NBFCs, how they are regulated and how their regulation is different from the regulation of banks. Then a recent phenomena or a recent, you can say, happening in NBFC is scale-based framework, which has been introduced by the RBI. This is very important from exam point of view. And another important topic is risk-based internal audit for NBFCs. So these all you need to study for non-banking financial institutions. So I hope guys that you must have liked this video, as I have tried to cover the entire syllabus of economics in as much detail as possible. So the syllabus is a bit lengthy, but if you start preparing from now onwards, you can easily cover the whole syllabus. Okay. So all the very best friends, I will come up with more such videos in future. So stay connected with our channel. Have a nice day.